staying with the theme of the moment, which is autographs from old-time baseball players from the turn of the century, the so-called dead ball era. Here's another one. So let's go. Rube Johnson played one season of minor league ball in 1912 for the Duluth White Sox, and he threw right-handed. So that's today's episode, folks. Thanks for stopping by the Chuckle Bucket. It's been great. Be sure to tip your waitress and drive home safe. Thank you and good night, everybody. But really, that's all the info I could find on Rube Johnson. How do I make an episode out of that? Well, I could spend a year and a day going through the obituaries looking up the last name Johnson on a guy I don't have a date of birth for. Yeah, I'll pass on that. And instead, I'll just say, on with the show. Another old-timer show. So let's hit it. And head to Minnesota, not to the small town of Nisswa, located on the Paul Bunyan Trail that I visited, population less than 2,000, and I was advised by more than one local to stay out of Crow Wing County Jail. But we're headed to the big city, the city of Duluth. Besides the Duluth White Sox, the Central International League had three other teams: the Grand Fork Flickertails, the Superior Red Sox, and the Winnipeg Maroons. This was Class C ball at the turn of the century. The Duluth Minnesota White Sox were managed by Thomas O'Brien, and they had a 23-man roster, and of the 23, only 14 had a date of birth listed. Not Rube Johnson. 14 listed the city from which they came. Not Rube Johnson. Only three players had their height and weight listed. Not Rube Johnson. Four players were noted for which way they hit and threw. Not Rube Johnson. And of the 23 players, only two have all of that info listed. Not much info to go on. Yeah, I thought I was going to say Rube Johnson, huh? During my research, I found that two of these players were in the majors. Elmer Miller was a New York Yankee, and Red Bluhm played for the Boston Red Sox for one game. Also on this team from Manchester, England was Si Bennett. Did not play in the majors, but played 9 years of pro ball in a few leagues. Records show he was born in 1882 and would have been the oldest player on the team at 29, but it could have been somebody else. So what is Rube Johnson doing at a Seals stadium in 1955 signing my dad's autograph book? There's four other signatures on that same page, including Walter Duster Mails and Ted Beard, known as the Arm. The two other signatures I can't figure out. The previous page has San Francisco Seals manager Tom Heath, their pitcher Steve Nagy, and Ty Cobb. I think these autographs all relate to a game played in San Francisco between the Seals and the Cleveland Indians, spring of 1955. Rube Johnson would be about the same age as Ty Cobb and Walter Mails, and all three were born in the late 1800s. And the way I see it, Rube Johnson was probably schmoozing with Ty and Duster, watching one of the best teams of the era, the Cleveland Indians. And in 1955, my dad was in sixth grade. His big sister worked in the Seals front office, and they had a nickname, the Little Corporation. That all came to an end after the 55 season when they were sold to the Boston Red Sox. Duster Mails worked for the Seals, and my dad ran into him a few times at the office and has a couple of his autographs, one in the book and one on a Seals scorebook. The other is on the page, same as Rube Johnson. It's in the thumbnail. So, to fill out the Rube Johnson show, I'll take a minute and talk about Walter Mails, a.k.a. Walter the Great, or Duster. That was the nickname he gave himself. And you know what they say about guys who give themselves nicknames. Ego. Born in 1894, just outside the walls of San Quentin Prison, he went to St. Mary's College. There's my tie-in right there, what you're looking at. I always like to mention St. Mary's College when I can. Here's a newspaper writer's opinion of Walter. Walter is the most pompous, arrogant, and egotistical ballplayer ever to don a uniform. That's pretty descriptive. Is that the kind of guy you want on your team? Well, yeah, because 9 times out of 10, if he's good and can back up his talk, you need that on your club. Plus, it rubs off on you. And in sports, you need a spark plug to keep that fire lit under your team. And sure, it can wear on you. Everything in moderation, and that's where a good manager comes in. But really, in the long, long run, Duster Mails just sounds like a typical turn-of-the-century baseball player. sharp spikes and fist fights? Spitballs and then some highballs. So Duster was a lefty, and a mean lefty at that. He always had a bad temper and would have no problem brushing you off the plate. That's a given. And then throw a pitch that might dust you in more ways than one. And don't try digging in on Duster or give him the stink eye, because he'll sweep you off your feet as he whizzes one past your head. Or just flat out beans you. Yeah, take your base. I'll see you again in a couple of innings. Also known as Walter the Great, because that's what he was at the end of September 1920 when he won 7 games without a loss, including 2 shutouts with a 1.85 ERA and helped the Cleveland Indians win the AL pennant. Next up, the World Series, where Walter would turn himself into a hero and a legend, as well as a World Series champ. In that 1920 World Series, he pitched 6-plus shutout innings in Game 3, and then when he found out he was tapped to start Game 6, Duster Mails went around boasting and telling everybody that he was going to shut out the Brooklyn Robins. So what's the guy with a big ego and a propensity to brag do? Just what he said he was going to do. Walter Mails backed up his talk with a 1-0 3-hit shutout over the Robins, and a couple of days later, the Indians were the World Series champions. Walter the Great Mails played 7 seasons in the majors, and his record, 32-25. And since the age of 19, he played in parts of 21 seasons, 7 of those pitching for the Seals in the minors. He had 258 wins and 235 losses. So I'll wrap up today's episode on Rube Johnson, whose entire biography consisted of one sentence. But his autograph had a real nice tie-in with the Walter Mails autograph. So, of the 23 men on the 1912 Duluth White Sox roster, 7 players are listed by a single name only. Is it their first name or their last name? Who knows with some of those old-time names? Half the time, they're nicknames anyway. Lucky for me, Rube Johnson was listed with a first and last name. Although it didn't help me with his bio. Anyways, I don't think his mom and dad named him Rube. That's probably a nickname. Of course, you never know. The way they named kids back then at the turn of the century. Which century?